A few months' time, millions of people in this country will be able to use 5G. It may not change our lives overnight, but it will mean our smartphones will be even smarter, faster and much more reliable. But, and this is a very big but for many experts in the field, it brings serious risks with it. At least it does, if we are to believe the warnings about the giant Chinese company Huawei, which is the leading telecoms company in the field and which might be involved in running our system. This morning, a report by the Foreign Affairs think tank, the Henry Jackson Society, written by an MP and security experts, warns it would be putting China in a potentially exploitative position over our telecom system. In the United States, President Trump has signed an executive order that's seen as a firing shot across Huawei's bond, effectively saying, stay away from them. The company itself says the fears are misplaced. Tim Watkins, their vice president for Western Europe, spoke to this program on Tuesday.
Huawei, again, is a private company that is not controlled by the government. And there is no obligation on our part whatsoever to ensure that the data that is passing across our own networks or anybody else's networks must be handed over to any Chinese government department.
What you are saying is in contrast, in stark contrast, to the terms of that 2017 law. What would you do if there was a request that came to you under that national intelligence law?
It would be refused.
Well, that was Tim Watkins talking to Michelle. Let's talk about that to Sir Mark Lyle-Grant, who was this country's national security advisor from 2015 till 17, and also to retired American Air Force Brigadier General Robert Spalding, who was senior director for strategic planning at the American National Security Council until February of last year. Sir Mark, should we take what we just heard from Tim Watkins at face value?
I'm not sure we should take that at face value, no. I think there's been some more recent suggestions of a no-spying agreement that Huawei would be prepared to sign with the British government. I wouldn't attach much value to that, frankly, because China is an intelligence and security risk. Not only from espionage, they're trying to steal intellectual property, steal industrial secrets, but also potentially more damaging through involvement in critical national infrastructure in this country. So I don't take that at face value. But that does not mean that we should not allow Huawei to play some role in the future 5G network, in my view.
Such as?
Well, if we believe the leaks from the National Security Council, the intention of the government, although no decision has been taken, is to not allow Huawei to be involved in some of the core sensitive aspects of the 5G network, but to be allowed in some of the non-core work, building transmitter antennae and things like that. Now, that decision taken, if it was taken, by the National Security Council last month, would have been on the basis of intelligence advice from the head of GCHQ, from the National Cybersecurity Center, who have been monitoring Huawei for more than 10 years, because Huawei has been involved with the 2G, 3G, 4G networks in this country for more than 10 years now. So I think our intelligence experts are well aware of the potential threat. And if they advise that there are ways of mitigating, managing, minimizing that threat, then I have no difficulty with the government making the sort of compromise decision that apparently it's moving towards.
General Spalding, what about what Donald Trump had to say? Is he right to warn America off Huawei?
I think this executive order was a long time coming. It's well known that Huawei acts in many ways as an agent of the Chinese Communist Party. And so banning the type of activity that they do within our networks really makes a lot of sense. But more importantly, I think it doesn't really get to the root of the problem. And the root of the problem is that in our world, data is so important to our society and it needs to be secured.
Needs to be secured why, though? Are we thinking in terms of commercial interest, privacy, or perhaps, not perhaps, infinitely more important, national security? That's to say, the Chinese, if they abuse the system, would know, and this is perhaps a question for you first, Sir Mark, they might know if we were planning to send warships into the China Sea or whatever it happened to be. In other words, there are profoundly important effects on our national security.
Well, clearly there are some risks. There's a risk of straightforward espionage, stealing secrets. There's also a risk that at a time of crisis, there might be the ability of Huawei to deny service, to disrupt, to sabotage the 5G networks. Now, those threats are real, but they have been understood and recognised for some years now. And that is why the government has already taken a number of steps to ensure that Huawei can't take those sorts of actions. And there is a Huawei Cybersecurity Evaluation Centre that was set up some years ago in Oxfordshire. It has an oversight board which is chaired by originally the head of GCHQ, now the head of the National Cybersecurity Centre, Kieran Martin. And that oversight board produces an annual report to the National Security Advisor. I received them in my time as National Security Advisor, which sets out exactly what the risks are and what action is being taken to mitigate those risks. So the decision that was discussed by the National Security Council last month would have been taken in the light of that report. And the most recent report came out in March this year, and it's been published on the government website. In the light of the position of the US administration, in the light of this 2017 Chinese law, which requires Chinese companies to cooperate with their intelligence services on certain occasions. So it would have been in the light of all those facts that discussion would have taken place. And if, as I say, the decision was taken on the basis of expert intelligence advice, I have no difficulty with the outcome. Mm. Don't forget that Theresa May is a particularly strong on the issue of Chinese security from her time as Home Secretary. You'll recall that when one of her first acts on becoming Prime Minister in 2016 was to order a review of the decision to build a Hinkley Point C nuclear plant because of Chinese involvement in that project. So she is very tough on this issue. So if she decides on the basis of expert advice that the risks can be mitigated, then I don't see that as an unreasonable decision.
And General, what do you think about the effect it might or might not have on the so-called Five Eyes intelligent community, Australia, Canada, New Zealand, the United Kingdom and the United States?
Well, considering the executive order, I think going forward you have to be believe that over time the willingness to share information with the Five Eyes partners and really any ally or partner that has a close personal relationship with Huawei or the Chinese Communist Party is going to be threatened.
Seriously?
Seriously.
I would be surprised if that was the case, frankly, John. There was a meeting of the Five Eyes intelligence chiefs shortly after that National Security Council discussion where this would have been thoroughly discussed. President Trump himself is coming to this country in 3 weeks' time and will no doubt discuss that issue. But I would be most surprised if there was any impact on the very close intelligence relationship between the United Kingdom and the United States.
Well, that's quite shocking, considering the president said this is a national security emergency and we're banning them from our own networks. So it really doesn't make a lot of sense that we would want to share data with nations that have those types of companies in their networks.
Well, the position of the United States, I say, is well known and would have been taken into account at that decision of the National Security Council. Now, a final decision, as I understand it, has not been taken by the government, and President Trump's latest announcement may have some impact on that. The Henry Jackson Society report will no doubt be looked at by government experts.
That's the report I referred to earlier.
Exactly. Will be looked at very carefully by the experts. Now, maybe that will have an influence on the eventual decision. But what I'm trying to make the point is that this is not a new risk. It's been known for over 10 years dealing with Huawei in this country, and therefore we have a great deal of experience of Huawei and its operations with our telecoms companies, with BT, with Vodafone, EE3. All these companies have been involved working with Huawei. So I think we're in a good position to assess that risk, and no doubt we will be discussing it very in detail with our American colleagues.
And having done that, General, if we do go ahead with Huawei, what would be the effect?
The whole Huawei debate actually takes us away from the discussion on what are the implications of China owning essentially the backbone of most countries in the world in terms of 5G. And then what does that mean when a totalitarian regime actually has the ability to do global surveillance, do targeted influence, and really, when you add all the connectivity with the self-driving cars and other things, to use those vehicles and other things in ways that are inimical to our own principles. You know, how do you preserve the principles that we, you know, and certainly the Atlantic Charter was founded under, certainly democratic principles and free market principles, when the world is changing in ways where we thought that we could push liberal values into totalitarian regimes using globalization and the internet. And really what we find is we're censoring ourselves. And so what's happening is our principles, our democratic principles, are slowly being changed as we adopt these companies, their standards, their policies into our own lives, into our own societies.
General Spaulding, Sir Mark Lahlgren, thank you both very much.
Thank you.